Welcome to the Knife Junkie Podcast, your weekly dose of knife news and information about knives and knife collecting. Here's your hosts, Jim Person and Bob the Knife Junkie DeMarco.
Hello, I'm Jim Person.
And I'm Bob DeMarco. Welcome to the Knife Junkie Podcast. Jim, how are you?
I'm doing great. Looking forward to an exciting show on the Knife Junkie Podcast. How about you?
Oh, indeed. We're gonna have two special segments tonight. We have a first tool segment where we talk about the karambit, go in depth on that Indonesian fighting knife. And then we're gonna talk about some major pet peeves and some real matters of importance that knife collectors embrace when they're collecting knives that really might not be so important.
Being kind of international here, you mentioned the karambit, but we also have a knife laws segment. Going to talk about a law from jolly old London, England.
Yes, they have some of the best and most comprehensive knife laws in the world. So we're going to talk about those for a quick sec.
Well, we're not going to talk about the knife in my pocket and our pocket check because you've got this week four knives in your pocket.
I do. It's a little ridiculous. This morning, I broached the question to my daughter. I said, "What should I carry today?" And I held up a ZT-0630. That's a Emerson collaboration, the one that looks like the horseman. And then I held up the Sinkovich design 0462, and she said, "Carry them both." And I said, "Capital idea. I like how you think. Put them both in my pocket." And then, of course, I needed a slip joint, so the GEC-15 single bladed spear point fit the bill. And then instead of the pink cold steel broken skull in the waistband, today I went with the Black Talon 2, which, as you can see, is quite a menacing blade. It's an S shape, and I don't know. It just made me feel extra secure
today.
Well, this
is a milestone, if you will. The cold steel broken skull first week hadn't been there.
Indeed.
This thing
felt big and bulky by comparison, and it is a thin knife, so.
Right.
That just tells you how slim and slender the broken skull is.
So if Bob's got four this week, I've got my buck canoe. And coming up, we're going to get into one of the show segments that I really enjoy, history and knowledge and learning. The first tool is coming up.
And now for a look at a historical innovation in knife design. It's time for the Knife Junkies, the first tool.
A karambit is a small claw-bladed knife that has seen an uptick in popularity in the West over the past decade. In a traditional grip, the karambit blade curves down and out from the bottom of the fist, secured with a forefinger ring at the butt end of the handle. The ring fixes the knife to the user's hand, making it difficult to disarm. It also allows for mid-motion grip changes as well as striking with the knife, with an enhanced security of retention. Evolved from a traditional Southeast Asian agricultural hand sickle, the modern karambit has become synonymous with self-defense knife. The original field implements were used to thresh plants, dig roots, and plant rice, but as its potential as a weapon was fully realized, most likely in western Sumatra, the curve of the blade was exaggerated to optimize its cutting and ripping capabilities. Due to extensive trade and the general maritime nature of Southeast Asia, the karambit spread to countries like Thailand, Cambodia, Laos, and the Philippines. Use of the karambit spread throughout the martial arts of the region as well. Due to its concealability and versatility, the karambit has become the main weapon of the deadly close combat Indonesian martial art Penjak Silat and is a staple in the Filipino martial arts as well. Incidentally, the use of the karambit is looked down upon by some martial artists of the region. The perception of the weapon is as an assassin's tool or a farmer's tool. Either way, it's seen as a weapon beneath those belonging to the esteemed warrior class. Today, the folding karambit has been embraced by Westerners outside of the martial arts due to its nasty looks and presumed intuitive nature. You will hear it called the deadliest weapon in a fistfight or the ultimate self-defense knife. Maybe it is, but in the hands of Leo Gahe Jr. or Danny Nosanto, you could safely call a soup spoon the deadliest weapon in a fight. So clearly, the karambit itself is second to training in martial efficacy. That being said, in well-trained hands, the karambit can be frightening, confusing, quick, and deadly little implement. And with proper training and consideration, it can be worked seamlessly into your law enforcement or civil sheepdog carrying systems.
And that's this week's look at knife history with the first tool. And now back to the Knife Junkie Podcast.
All right, good info there, Bob, on the first tool about the karambit. And again, I'm really thinking the first tool is becoming one of my favorite segments that we do, just because, you know, it's got some history. You know, I can kind of visualize and see the knife kind of evolving as you're talking about it. So I'm really digging the first tool. I'm gonna vote that we do this one a little more often than not.
I love the first tool also because it gives me an opportunity to look at the legacy of the modern knives that we carry around today and the knives I hope to be making tomorrow. But to see how they trace back into history and to see how blade shapes and other utilities have evolved, it's pretty cool.
Right. Yeah, it sounds cool. And hopefully we've got something cool for our main show segment that we're going to be talking about. Maybe it might offend some listeners. Who knows? Maybe some listeners will go, yeah, I agree with that. But we're going to be kind of talking about pet peeves, yeah. Right, of knife collectors.
Yeah, pet peeves and things that knife collectors look for that, you know, require some suspension of disbelief. It's kind of, you have to just trust and believe that these are things that you right. need in a knife if you're not using it at all.
You know? Right. All right. Well, you've got 12 of these, random order. It's not a 1 to 12 or 12 to 1. So let's kick it off. What I guess what's first on your list of things that stick in your craw?
So I was sitting here looking over a brand new knife and just thinking about some of the things. The first thing that popped out at me is billboarding. Billboarding is too much writing or big writing on a blade.
Oh, okay.
So you'll have something like this rake knife. And by the way, they spell rake, R-U-I-K-E. Yeah. Yeah, right. Go figure. But anyway, on one side, it has rake, which is the name of the manufacturer. On the other side, it has the model number, which is P801-SF. SF stands for satin finish. And then it has the steel designation below that. And then it has this wicked long model number right on the ricasso. And it's just a lot of writing. And most knife collectors prefer what we call a sterile blade, a blade with as little writing on it as possible. So I would say billboarding is one of the number one annoyances. It doesn't affect the blade. Here, I'll give you an example. The best example is my beloved Cold Steel Broken Skull. It's such a cute pink knife, but right on the black blade, it says Broken Skull in giant, giant 15-point, font. And
right.
I just can't stand it, but I overlook it. So billboarding, number one.
Well, it seems like for the Broken Skull, that would be the writing would be nice as a display piece. But for the rake knife, that just it.
It's too much information. It's yeah, like put it in the paperwork. You know what
right.
I'm saying?
Right. All right. Number two on your list.
A recurved blade. Recurved blade, Jim, is like this blade here where it curves down into a belly and back into another curve. And it helps accelerate cutting as you're pulling the blade through whatever medium you're cutting. That curve kind of bunches up the material and pushes it deeper into the blade. And so it accelerates your cutting, but it's kind of a pain in the butt to sharpen. At least it is if you're using flat stones. But it's really no problem if you use a ceramic rod, which is obviously round in cross section, or you use like a Spartaco sharp maker that has these triangle corners that has a triangular stones that you sharpen with the corners. So you can handle a recurve without a problem, but it is a really huge turnoff to a lot of people and they will not buy a knife because it has that little curve on it.
Interesting. Interesting. Even though it might look nice and perform exceptionally.
Excellently. Yeah. 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 And to me, I love it because they remind me of Filipino blades. They always have a nice swooping downward curve right. and belly. So I've always right. loved the recurve. Okay. Doesn't bother me at all.
But for some, it may.
Yeah, exactly. But they're wrong. Yeah. The next one is blade centering.
Okay.
Blade centering. Now you see how this blade sits right in the center between those two handles. Mm-hmm. That's a sign of on par manufacturing at this point. If a blade comes uncentered, people freak out, myself included.
And why is that?
I think for a couple of reasons. One is it's not that hard, apparently, to make a blade that's centered, because you can buy a $5 Walmart knife, Ozark Trail Walmart knife, and it'll come centered. So why can't this $200 Benchmade I just bought come centered? Why do I have to fiddle with it and Loctite it and get a papal dispensation for this thing to be centered? Hmm. So it's kind of just a prerequisite when you're laying down a lot of cash.
Right. Now, does that blade becoming uncentered, is that part of what happens during shipping or transit, or is it more something in the manufacturing process?
Well, if it shows up uncentered, it's something that happened in the manufacturing process. If it, some knives, like if you fiddle with them a long time, fidget with them, they will, the pivot will start to loosen up and it will gradually come out of true. And all you do is tighten it back up and kind of tweak it a little bit. It will recenter itself, maintaining the action, and you'll be fine if it's a well-manufactured knife. But if it shows up uncentered and there's no blade play, meaning there's no wiggle in the blade when it's out, then you're kind of screwed. Then you kind of know it's a manufacturing problem, and you either have to take the whole thing apart or send it back. And if the blade comes really off center and it rubs against the scale on either side, the lining of the handle on either side, then you get scratches on the blade, and that'll really send a knife junkie into a tizzy. So you know.
Okay. But is that
centering?
Yeah. Does that happen to tie into number five on the list, or is that going to be on the list eventually?
Well, yeah, it does, and that's lockup. That's how the blade locks up when it comes out. And we're talking about a folding locking knife, obviously. So lockup is important because you don't want the blade to wiggle, because you'll feel that every time you cut. And you don't want the blade to close on your fingers, because that's obviously not desirable.
Right.
But the thing about lockup I want to talk about is this perceived necessity for a steel lock face insert when it's a titanium framed frame lock. And titanium frame locks are sort of the pinnacle of knives right now, or I should say the most common, highly desirable, and expensive knives are most likely titanium frame locks. And there's this perception that in order to avoid lock stick, because titanium is a softer material than hardened steel, sometimes that lock interface where the locking leaf holds the blade open can become sticky. And so most manufacturers now have a little piece of steel in there so that it's steel on steel contact, and you don't get that stickiness,
right,
or that wearing down of the material over time. And that's all fine and good, but I think it's allowed a little bit of slop to come into the manufacturing process. And this is not slop that I've seen. This is all hypothetical. But if a Chris Reeve Sebenza knife, or a Rick Hinderer XM18 knife, or a Spyderco Spidey Chef, which are all titanium frame lock folders, can operate flawlessly and smoothly without any lock stick, without having that lock bar insert, is this just a shortcut? It's just a question. So. Lockup is a big thing. This steel lock face insert is a big thing.
Right.
And I wonder if it's not just an easier way to get great lockup.
Interesting question. And I don't know the answer.
Who does? This is something you sit under waterfalls and contemplate, Jim.
This is
heavy stuff.
Yeah. I'm telling you, we're getting deep here.
Yeah, we are. And I'll keep it light. Like a couple of other things. You hear a lot about thickness behind the edge. That's how thick the blade is on the main bevel right before you get to the final cutting edge. And so a lot of YouTubers now will take out their calipers and do this very difficult measurement, which is trying to measure the thickness behind the edge of a very thin blade. And they'll read off some number like 125 thousandths. Oh, this is gonna slice great. And I never quite can remember what the good numbers are. You know,
right.
I know the thinner the better, I guess, but so that's a funny thing you hear a lot about, this thickness behind the edge.
It's quite anal to me.
It is totally anal. If you're buying your pocket knife to slice tomatoes all day, you know, I got news for you, buy a kitchen knife.
Right.
This thickness behind the edge thing is funny. One website, I can't remember who it is now listing that in their specs for each knife.
Wow.
I'm like, man, they got some guy with calipers and a pallet full of knives, and this poor dude's measuring the thickness behind each edge.
Yeah.
Okay, here's a big one I want to talk about. and that's steel. And I know this has come up time and again in our discussions, but being a steel snob, I used to think was repugnant. You know, you would rather pay $400 than $40 for a knife that can do the same thing that you just probably have to resharpen a little more frequently. But in the ensuing years since I developed that opinion, I have actually become a bit of a steel snob. And I got to admit, I'm a sucker for certain alphanumeric combinations, like S35VN is a base at this point. M390, boy, I hear that. And I know I'll be cutting for a long time.
Like, ooh, that's a good one there.
So really what I'm saying here is it's a total leap of faith, because I know that I don't, even my cheapest blade steel, you know, my old OS 8 cold steels, I've never really pushed those to the limit. I mean, yes, I've dulled them, but any one of those knives would be adequate for the rest of my life, I'm quite certain. But I have spent so much time and resources kind of trying to acquire knives that have this more expensive steel, more esteemed steel. I just want to give an example of how this is, how the whole steel thing, spending a lot of money on a knife because it's got a certain steel, is a total leap of faith. Columbia River Knife and Tool CRKT a couple of years ago came out with a special edition Hootenanny. They came out with the in budget materials, and then they decided to do a special edition with carbon fiber and S30V steel. That was the selling proposition of this knife. Buy the Hootenanny for the S30V steel. And then a bunch of people started coming back with news that this must not be S30V steel because it's rusting like M4, or it's rusting like a high carbon steel. And it's starting to patina immediately. And it just kind of illustrated or put into sharp relief how you really don't know what steel you're getting. And unless you are doing the serious tests that like Pete from Cedric and Ada channel are doing and really testing out these steels, you probably aren't going to really know the difference between S30V and M390, mm-hmm. except when you go to sharpen it.
Right. It seems like that's really for the more advanced collector. I mean, we're talking levels here of collecting, because for me right now in my journey of knives and knife collecting, that's not a big issue. That's not something that's even on my radar for me to think about.
Right. But it becomes a slippery slope, Jim. I'll tell you that, because, once you develop a taste for certain designers and once you develop a taste for certain brands, you're going to be pulled in that direction. In any case, it's going to draw you upward in terms of your commitment, commitment in terms of buying these knives.
Right. All right. Well, we'll see as my journey continues. I think we're about halfway through your list of pet peeves, so I'll let you continue on.
Action is a big thing. Action, and this is in folding knives. How the blade is deployed and how it closes. Does it fall shut? That's the big thing. You know, when you take the frame lock, take the titanium frame lock folder and hold it with the edge towards the ground, and you release the lock, does the blade swing freely down? And if the answer is yes, it means it's high quality because it's on bearings. If no, you better do some work on that knife, or, you know, maybe it's just not up to par. So basically, must the knife fall shut to be a good knife? Before this fall shutty thing started with the ball bearings, it used to be a hydraulic action you were looking for. That was often how Chris Reeve Sabenzas were referenced. The action has a hydraulic feel going in and out. I must admit, for fidgeting, I love the thrill of just releasing the lock and having the blade swing down. But for fidgeting, I also like the hydraulic feel. So really, that's a lot of what this all comes down to, is what your fidget preference is. Because, Jim, if you really need to cut that knife, the knife's going to come open one way or another, and it doesn't matter how smoothly it happens. So it's about, okay, I just spent $300. I want to make sure a lot of thought and care has gone into this manufacturing and design. I mean, that's a real big part of it.
Sure.
It's the, you know, fetishizing of the object itself.
Well, and, you know, if you're going to spend that type of money, certain things, as you said, the beauty is in the eye of the beholder, you know, certain ways you feel about the action, et cetera, are going to be different than other people. So it's kind of a, again, personal pet peeve or personal preference type of thing. So again,
yeah,
you know, take all these maybe with a grain of salt, but also understand if you're a knife collector, you're probably feeling the same about some or all of these that Bob is talking about. So kind of be realistic as well as you're thinking about yourself and your knives.
Well, and these ideas come on in tides, you know. You see enough people that you know and like and trust reviewing these products on the internet, and those companies who are producing those products also see those reviews, and they're also taking notes. And if they see enough reviewers saying this fall shutty action is so desirable, well, that's what they're going to aim towards, which is great because that means they're responding quickly to their client base.
Right, which they should.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
Couple other here. Tip up versus tip down. Do you know what that means?
The tip is either up or the tip is either down.
Yes, it's the carry. It's how you're carrying it.
Okay.
So it's it has to do with position of the pocket clip on a folding knife. And if it's at the butt end, that means you're carrying it tip up because when it's sitting in your pocket like this, folded, the tip is pointing up.
Oh.
This is the preferred method for 90% of the knife world. And that 90% is scientifically arrived at, Jim. So don't try and challenge me on that.
Well, you know, what do they say, Bob? 75% of statistics are made up or something. I'm not sure.
Yeah, right, exactly. So when you know, at the birth of the modern folder and pocket clips first started appearing on knives, they were mostly tipped down. And that remained for a long time. And then you started getting the option tip up, tip down. And I prefer tip up for sure. But I have a couple of knives. My Microtech SOCOM Elite and my Spyderco Military leave you no choice but to carry tip down. And I love those knives and I would never stop wearing them just because of that. But you'll see some funny reactions to the whole concept of tip down.
Right.
If you watch enough YouTubers talking about knives.
And you said again, tip down is when the pocket clip and it's in your pocket and the tip is pointed down, correct? As you're carrying it.
Yeah, that's tip down. And that's undesirable because the idea is if it's tipped down in your pocket, it can open up and be open in your pocket. But if it's tipped down, the knife is against the blade is against the seam of the pocket and won't open up in there. So, but I've never had a tipped down knife open up in my pocket. I'm not saying it can't happen, but you know, again, it's just preference. And then people get very married to their opinions on these things.
Right.
And sometimes even get combative about them, which is so ridiculous.
Well, as you were talking about it, I was sitting here thinking from a combative standpoint, self-defense standpoint, personal safety standpoint, et cetera, I'm just visualizing in my mind, it seems to me that tip down would be preferential. Because the tip is down and you reach into your pocket and then as you're opening it, the tip is already down so that it swings up as it's opening and it would be better, you know,
I think,
if you had to use it quickly. But
yeah, well, you are intuiting, I don't want to say correctly, but that was, I've seen many Marshall blade kind of videos. And in the earlier days of the folding tactical folder, that was a thing. That really was how people drew it, and they kind of braced their arm against their hip, and they had the knife in position. I mean, it really, when you are carrying tip down, the knife does come out in quite a convenient position.
Yeah.
You can open it without changing your grip. Whereas, you know, tip down, unless you've got an Emerson Wave, you are going to have to adjust your grip a little bit.
Hmm.
Now, that's only important if you're using your knife, drawing your knife tactically and then, you know, have to do it quickly. Chances are that's not going to be the case. So just casually sliding it out of your pocket and flipping it open and repositioning it in your hand is not going to be an issue.
So a lot of controversy, a lot of discussion over a very minor potential issue.
Well, that's what nerds in any interest, you know, you get into the weeds like that.
Right.
You know, sharpening coil.
All right. Well, let's get into the weeds on another pet peeve here on the Knife Junkie Podcast.
Well, since we're talking about pocket clips, I want to talk about deep riding pocket clips. These, see how that folds over like that? That allows the knife to sit inside the pocket and barely be detectable, except for the clip that's, you know, coming over the edge of your pocket. And it's very important to some people. To me, I don't want too much sticking out because I'm afraid, depending on what I'm doing, if too much of the knife is sticking out, it can work its way out naturally just through walking and moving and carrying a bag and other such things. But for me, a deep riding clip is, or lack thereof, is not a deal breaker. It's a nice luxury when it comes on a knife. And on occasion, I will buy an aftermarket clip to make it deep carry. But like I did with the Emerson Sax, had that audaciously low riding clip that just had half of the knife sticking out of the pocket. So it's just something that is important to people. And to me, I guess I prefer the deep ride.
Well, and I think I remember specifically a couple of videos you did on that on the Knife Junkie YouTube channel that you can find at thenifejunkie.com/YouTube, where you kind of went over that that deep pocket carry. So folks want to check that out. Go again, knifejunkie.com/YouTube.
So two other things, and then I'll let you ponder the depths of these issues we've raised. But walk and talk, you know, we have a segment called Walk and Talk. Walk and Talk and the Blade Pull Scale. Now, this is for people into traditional knives, slip joint knives. They have something called walk and talk, which is the sound and action of the blade as it comes out and snaps open. And then as it goes back in and snaps shut, that's called the walk and talk. How crisp that is, how loud that sound is, how clean the action is. And then there's also something that slip joint guys employ, and I'm calling it the blade pull scale, but you'll hear people say, oh, the pull on that blade. And that means like on your buck canoe, how hard it is to open up, is measured on a scale of 1 to 10, 1 being the weakest and 10 being the strongest.
Oh, okay.
So you'll hear a lot of people talking about their slip joints and they'll say, it's got about a 5 pull, you know, or a 6 pull. Oh, this one's pretty stout. It's like 7.5 or 8. And I love it because it gives you a good idea for what the feel must be. But at the same time, it just makes me laugh and giggle. 7.5. It's a 7.5 pull, not a 7 or an 8. I mean, just even calling it a 7 or an 8 is a little ridiculous, but because everything's relative, obviously.
I was going to say, because you're 7 and my 7 and, you know, Joe's 7, you know, lives down the street. They're all going to be different.
Yeah, thoroughly unscientific. That's why I love it. It makes me giggle. Same thing you hear with a lockup. When people look at the lockup on a folding knife, and they look at where the blade tang meets the titanium frame, and they say, "Oh, it's locked up at about 35%, maybe 40%," and that's just saying 40% of the lock interface is interfacing with the tang. And to me, when you see these videos, when you see any one of my favorite YouTubers and they talk about the percentage of lockup, to me, I'm always like, no, that looks more like 50 or 60%. So right. To me, it's like, it's totally random, but it's a source of enjoyment.
Wow.
For me anyway.
Right.
So walk and talk and blade pull.
Yeah. So some of these, Bob, I'm thinking, really? But some of these I'm thinking, well, you know, could be important to certain knife collectors and more of a factor for certain collectors. So I guess all of these are relative.
Well, what all of these things do is show the quality and care that went into the manufacturing. Really, that's what people want to see for their money. They want to make sure that the blade is centered, because that just means that someone was paying attention to that. They want to know that the walk and talk is crisp, because that means everything is measured and cut correctly. Other things like tip down, tip up, or recurves, or not to recurve, or billboarding even, that's a matter of personal taste.
Right.
But so this last one you'll understand, and everyone understands it, though it doesn't play much into my decision making when it comes to knife carry, and that's weight. So Nuttin' Fancy, the legendary knife reviewer, the first, if not the first, the guy who may as well be the first big knife reviewer on YouTube, he hit the scene in 2008. He established very early on, he's a military guy, and he established very early on that ounces are pounds and pounds are pain. So keep your knives light, because you got to carry a lot of other stuff. And so he had for folding knives, he has a 4-ounce limit, unless the knife offers some extra capability that it's worth carrying the extra weight. And his 4 ounces is what works for him. And it's sort of worked its way into, or is part of the foundation of, the YouTube knife review canon of knowledge. if someone says, oh, this isn't nothing fancy approved, you know that it's heavy. So that's something that people really, now I like to carry around an XM24, which is a big old Rick Hinderer knife. And it thing weighs close to maybe 8 ounces. Oh. And, you know, I don't wear it in, you know, when I'm wearing a suit, which is rare, but you know, I'll wear it with jeans or something stout enough that I don't feel that weight, but that weight doesn't bother me.
Yeah. Well, that one would be, probably as you said, yeah, that would be top on my list because if it, you know, if got a folding knife in my pocket, the weight is the big concern.
Especially if it's not clipped to your pocket, like your canoe.
Yeah. And I don't clip to my pocket. Maybe eventually I'll get to that point where I would like a pocket clip knife. I'll have to give it a try. But weight for me would be the big factor. Tip up, tip down, not a big factor for me. I'm not planning to get into a knife fight. So, you know, that's not an issue.
That's a good plan.
Yeah. Good plan always. But yeah, so interesting. I think some of these, again, are personal preference. Some of them are being really over the top as far as collecting and being specific about certain things of the knives. But again, you collect knives because you enjoy them and there's certain things you want them to do or have or be or see or sound like. So again, it comes back to your personal preference. And if you agree with any of these pet peeves, as we're calling them, or don't, or have comments about any of these that Bob has talked about, we'd love to hear from you and why. So give us a call on the listener line at 724-466-4487. Again, that's 724-466-4487. Love to hear your comments about any of these air quote pet peeves of knife collecting that the Knife Junkie has been talking about.
And one thing I'd like to add is that I have issues with all of these things to one extent or another, but I never let any of them stop me from checking out a really cool design that happens to be a cheap piece of crap. I know maybe that's a weakness. I don't know. But if I see something that I really like, I really try not to let my steel snobbery, for instance, stop me from buying it just because it has a steel that's labeled in a way I don't like. Mm-hmm. So I would say use some of these pet peeves as a guide for quality, just so you know that you've spent your money on something that is a decently produced product, but don't let any of them stop you from experiencing the wide depth and breadth that the knife world has to offer.
Right. And maybe one or two of them may be actually criteria for you that you have to begin your collection in certain categories or with certain styles or certain types of knives, but then you can expand and evolve over time and form your own opinions about some of them.
No analysis, no advice, just knife laws. We let the absurdity speak for itself. Here's this week's knife laws.
Today on Knife Laws, we're going across the pond and we're going to take a look at the knife laws in England, London to be specific. And these are as they were broken down on the gov.uk website. I do not believe that this is the actual law as it's written in their books. This is an interpretation. And if you live here in the United States, even if you live in a place like New York City, that's very, very extremely restrictive. Some of these UK knife laws make that look pretty good. So basic laws on knives. It is illegal to sell a knife to anyone under 18 unless it has a folding blade 3 inches long or less. It is illegal to carry a knife in public without good reason, unless it has a folding blade with a cutting edge 3 inches longer or less. It is illegal to carry, buy, or sell any type of banned knife. And it is illegal to use any knife in a threatening way, even a legal knife. And now we skip down a little bit, and they talk about locking knives and how a locking knife must have a blade that can be locked out and refolded by pressing a button. And it is not considered a folding knife. And even multi-tools count. So you can't even walk around London with a multi-tool. So here are the banned knives and weapons that it is illegal to bring into the UK, sell, hire, lend, or give to anyone. Butterfly knives or bally songs, disguised knives or blades sharpened to a point hidden inside what looks like everyday objects, flick knives, gravity knives, stealth knives, this is a good one, zombie knives, a knife with a cutting edge, a serrated edge, and images or words suggesting it is used for violence. The list goes on and on, including blowpipes and a whole bunch of Japanese weapons no one has heard of since the age of the samurai. I just wanted to skip down to good reasons for carrying a knife or a weapon.
Yeah, I'm interested in hearing the legal, lawful definition of what's a good reason.
So here are examples of good reasons to carry a knife or weapon in public. Taking knives you use at work to and from. Taking it to a gallery or a museum to be exhibited. If it is used in theater, film, television, historical reenactment, or religious purposes. Or if it'll be used in a demonstration to teach someone how to use it. So you can learn how to use a knife, you just can't carry it.
Right.
So the last line is good. A court will decide if you've got a good reason to carry a knife or a weapon if you're charged with carrying it illegally.
Okay.
So basically.
So you'll know after you get busted.
Yeah, exactly. That's exactly what I was going to say. So just, disarm and be a good citizen.
Right. So if you've got a trip planned to London, England, you might not want to carry around your knife.
Yeah. Maybe a little Swiss Army knife, but you didn't hear that here.
Right. And we're not lawyers. We're not providing legal advice. I want to make sure that's clear again here on the Knife Junkie Podcast. We just try to bring you occasionally knife laws. We just read them, let you do the interpretation, but providing some basic knowledge and understanding for you here on the Knife Junkie Podcast.
That's it for this week's episode of Knife Laws. And now back to the Knife Junkie Podcast.
All right. We are back on the Knife Junkie Podcast. And Bob, time flies when you're having fun or when you're talking knives.
Sure does.
Time for this show is already over.
Yes, indeed, Jim. You wind me up, get me talking about knives, and that's it.
Let's do a quick recap, though. We're talking pet peeves about knives and knife collecting. Some of them may seem trivial. Some of them you're like, okay, well, yeah, I can see that. I can live with that. I can understand it. And some of them are like, yes, absolutely, or whoa, dude, no way. So there's kind of a range and a scale here. Here are some things we're talking about. So kind of final thoughts, kind of recap on our main show topic today.
Well, whether you find any of these pet peeves or if you find any of them to be ridiculous, you're probably right. If you find any of them to be extremely important, you're also probably right. I would say use these things as guides to quality.
Well, and I would be curious and I would be interested to hear from our listeners. And I'm encouraging folks to give us a call on the listener line at 724-466-4487 and let us know about any of these pet peeves, if you want to call it that, criteria, factors. You know, do you agree with the knife junkie? Do you think he's fallen off his rocker or any of
what did I miss? Yeah. What did I miss? And what am I not placing enough value on?
Yeah, we'd love to hear your opinion.
And then we can do a recap.
We'd love to hear from you. So again, 724-466-4487 and let us know your thoughts on pet peeves. Again, put the air quotes around it. Pet peeves of knife collecting and factors for a knife to add to your collection.
Thanks for listening to the Knife Junkie Podcast. If you enjoyed the show, please rate and review at reviewthepodcast.com. For show notes for today's episode, additional resources, and to listen to past episodes, visit our website, theknifejunkie.com. You can also watch our latest videos on YouTube at theknifejunkie.com/YouTube. Check out some great knife photos on theknifejunkie.com/Instagram, and join our Facebook group at theknifejunkie.com/Facebook. And if you have a question or comment, email them to Bob@theknifejunkie.com or call our 24/7 listener line at 724-466-4487, and you may hear your comment or question answered on an upcoming episode of the Knife Junkie Podcast.